Hi, my name is Eve, and thank you for checking out this video. The topic of this video is going to be about getting to neutral, different ways to get to neutral. And somebody asked me about this, making a video about this topic, and I thought it was a really great idea, so I'm happy to be doing this. I worked on what it meant to feel neutral for over 10 years now. And it started off with actually movement, understanding home base in movement. And for me, that was ice skating movement at first. And for example, when you bring your feet together and you bend, and before you're going to take a push in ice skating, that's, for me, I called that a home base place. Now, I'll just show you what I mean. But like, if you're standing up and you have your feet together and you're bending before you're going to take a push, I call that home base. And there's a feeling of connection to your center. You exhale, you feel grounded right there. And things, all the energy, like you feel more energy coming towards the middle of your body before you're going to extend back out into space again. And so I explored this feeling of like a neutral place to start from before I would take a push. And so I was kind of understood that concept in a physical way. And then I started to think of neutral as an emotional or a mental concept or construct. And that was also when I was part of the performing arts field and doing more performing and skating and dance. And what I read it in an acting book, where if you come in to a rehearsal or to a performance and you're in a neutral emotional state, it's easier for you to perform the choreography or to read the lines and like be able to reach different emotional places that are part of the show that you're performing. Because if you already come in with a strong emotion, then it's going to be that much harder to get to another emotion, or it's just going to have to be navigated, like how do you get from this strong emotion over to that one, as opposed to being in more of a neutral place, and then it's easier to get to different emotions as you need them for whatever you're performing. That could also be, you know, described as like a palette of paint. So you have like a neutral color in the middle, or no color, neutral color in the middle, and then the different primary colors or, you know, more clear colors, more striking colors are around the edges. And so it's easier to have a clearer red or a clearer blue or a clearer green if you are aware of like being able to start from a more neutral color. So it doesn't muddy your colors up if you have, like if you're already red and then you're trying to get to blue, then it's like kind of muddies up all the feelings. So I became interested in it when I read about that in an acting book, and just as a way of understanding my emotions and starting to work on emotions. You know, there's some debate about whether you can truly ever be in a neutral emotion, but I think just kind of feeling like things are okay, you know, not having like an extreme emotion in any direction, but just sort of a gentle flow of different feelings. That's more of a neutral place, I would call it these days. Another way that I've worked on finding neutral was by building an internal witness. I also think of this as like developing a larger consciousness that is able to hold or witness what the rest of me is experiencing. So in dance movement therapy, there is a technique called authentic movement, and that is where there's someone who's the mover, who moves with their eyes closed from an inner impulse, and then there's someone else who functions as the witness. And the witness watches the mover and watches them in a non-judgmental way. And then they share reflections on the movement, but they're careful to not bring their own projections in so that they really just describe what they see. So I did a lot of authentic movement in my early 30s, mid-30s, and I was working to integrate this non-judgmental witness into my life in general. And I also used it when I watched other people move. But so this non-judgmental witness is, you know, can be like kind of removed, kind of distant a little bit from what's happening. But it just, you have to back up enough so that you can really see what's going on. If you're kind of sort of pulled in or wrapped up in something, it's harder to see what's happening because you're so engaged, you're so invested. So being able to have a way of separating or distancing yourself a little bit emotionally so that you're able to see things better, that's part of what I got from integrating this non-judgmental witness. And then I could notice if I was being critical of myself or if I had a lot of negative emotions going on. Building an internal witness that's able to, be conscious and see your experience without trying to stop it or shut it down or judge it, is also a really important part of building like a neutral center. And it feels like over time you can practice. I felt like I worked to practice to make that consciousness larger so that it could hold more emotions. So that, because my goal would be that I could allow some really extreme or intense or large feelings to come up, and that this external witness or consciousness would be so expansive that it would be able to hold anything that came up for me. Like a way of relating to myself where this internal parent is just so able to manage any feelings and so calm and so accepting of the feelings that the child feels like they can really let go and they feel safe in letting go because their parent is there to help manage anything. So I wanted my internal witness or my consciousness to be like that parent. And so that was also a pursuing of a neutral stance because if they had a strong emotion or were not in a neutral place, then they wouldn't be able to respond as much to whatever came up. So that was like my next step. And then another part was when I was doing some running and I became aware of the phenomena of runner's high. And I decided for myself that I did not want to experience runner's high because when I would feel the high, then I would get a crash afterwards. So that just could be me, you know, that doesn't happen, maybe it doesn't happen to other people, but for me, it did not feel good. So I started paying attention to noticing when it would start to happen, and then I would go to walking instead of running, and like, so that it would come back down. And every time I would start to experience a runner's high, I would switch back to walking to let those chemicals come back down. And the purpose behind that was something I was exploring called baseline. I wanted to have a baseline that felt good, that felt like, I wanted my basic mood to feel even, stable, smooth, comfortable, like everything was okay. You know, I wasn't asking for bliss, but I just wanted everything to feel okay, and I wanted that to be my mood baseline. So one way of working on that was if I explored movements or running or other things where I would feel a lot of high, I would just, you know, stop before it went all the way up so that I was able to just keep, understand what that feeling was like and use it to stay within where my normal moods were and then just kind of help my mood a little bit. So I do think another piece of being able to find a neutral place is being able to, you know, not expect a lot of your moods, but at the same time, do little things that help them a little bit. And then you're just kind of helping your mood stay in a smooth, stable place. So that also, for some reason, that also fits in with me with this idea of like being neutral, you know, like just being okay, like everything's fine. And you know, it's not there's not like a lot of different dynamics going on. And and then just one other idea that I want to mention is noticing if there's any chronic emotions that are being held in the body, or in a mind place too. But if you're holding a chronic emotion, you're going to that's going to color all of your experiences, and it's not going to make this concept of neutral feel very possible for you, because if you're always sad or you're always angry or you're always embarrassed, then that's going to take away the neutral. It's going to be like tinted glasses that you see the world and yourself through all the time. So if you have like a chronically held emotion, that usually indicates some kind of trauma that caused a freeze in your nervous system, which contributes to having a chronically held emotion, because that's your body's way of saying, there's still something to work out here, you know? So I do think trauma resolution therapies like somatic experiencing or EMDR can be helpful with working out those chronically held emotions. Also, just, you know, regular therapy or creative arts therapy or dance therapy can be really helpful. So it's you want to find a situation that feels safe enough where you're able to connect back to those old emotions and digest them and understand why they happened and heal the old wounds. So as you clear out baggage like that or just the past history like that, then that makes it more possible to go into new experiences with sort of a more blank slate place, or a place where you just feel like, you know, I'm okay, this is fine, like I'm open. So those are my main ideas about it. And if anyone, thank you for watching the video. I hope you like the video. This is my space that I see clients in. I love this space, a little video of the space. Absolutely love working in this space. And if you have any questions, feel free to reach out to me. My website will be in the links underneath. And I hope everyone's having a good day. Thank you.